Hi, welcome to the Signal Path. Today I'm going to talk to you about delta sigma modulators, specifically delta sigma modulators for analog to digital converters. I remember when I was an undergrad and I first learned about delta sigma ADCs, it seemed like magic. It was doing what appeared to be impossible. But once I learned about it, I began to appreciate it even more. And what I want to do today for you guys is to go through the step-by-step process of how these systems actually work and give you an appreciation, an intuitive understanding about how delta sigma ADCs achieve noise shaping and spectral shaping and all the things that they do. And I want to go through that with you step by step. I won't dive into the theory too much because I'm afraid I'll lose you as an audience, but I recommend that you guys go ahead and dig deeper into the theory of delta sigma modulators once I'm done here to really, really appreciate it to its depth. I will still tell you quite a lot of details about it, so I hope that you sit through the theory, because it's only after understanding that you can appreciate the circuit we're going to build at the end, as it is traditional on the signal path. We're going to talk about theory and then we're going to build it and measure it to cover the entire spectrum. And that's what I'm hoping that is special about the signal path, that it gives you this full range of experience about these. So bear with me through the theory. We're going to go through basic ADCs, delta sigma ADCs, really understand how it works. Then we'll build the circuit and measure it. And even measuring a delta sigma ADC is not so straightforward. There's a lot of subtlety, and those subtle details are the things that are hard to find in textbooks, and you have to really get your hands dirty to appreciate them. So bear with me, and we're going to do from beginning to the end. Here we go. So let's get started. I apologize for having to film my tablet here, but my screen capture software isn't working, so I think this should still come out fairly okay. So let's start very, very basic. What do we have? We have a very basic analog to digital converter. Now, inside an analog to digital converter, there's nothing more than a sampler, a quantizer, and a coder. The coder is essentially a digital block responsible for collecting the data from the quantizer. The most important components are the sampler and the quantizer. The sampler, of course, is what determines the output data rate. So the sampler, for example, sets the ADC sample rate to 1 gigasample per second. It is a sampler that you have to take into account when dealing with issues like anti-aliasing, and when you want to make sure that you meet the Nyquist criteria. The quantizer, it is what determines the quantization noise. A quantizer is what essentially takes your analog signal and quantizes it, maps it to discrete values, which then can then be represented by a digital value. An analog signal, of course, can have infinite set of values, but the quantizer will make sure that those values get mapped to digital bins, digital values that the quantizer can represent in the digital domain, and the coder will correct. So the quantization noise of an analog to digital converter is inserted into the system at the quantization level, not at the sampler. The sampler is responsible for spectral folding. That's why aliasing can happen. Even if you don't quantize and you sample something and you don't sample it with the Nyquist criteria, you can get aliasing. So having said that, what would the waveform look like? Well, here's the solid line. Here is an analog waveform, and the digital representation of that waveform by the quantizer is superimposed. So you can see that obviously the digital values, the quantized values, do not follow the analog waveform perfectly. So you're going to have some error signal, the quantization error signal, and I've shown that error signal here at the bottom. You can see that the error signal is always trapped between delta over 2 and minus delta over 2. And that makes sense because the delta is the distance between two quantization levels. So it's one of your least significant bits of your ADC. You cannot make an error larger than one LSP. Actually, you cannot make an error larger than half an LSP in theory, because if you were to move beyond that, you'll just simply jump onto the next quantization level. So because your error is always limited to within one LSP, you can model that, you can characterize that, and you can derive a statistical model for the behavior of this signal shown below. So how's that done? Well, here's our error signal again. And this error signal, we can make some assumptions about it, depending on the input signal. Let's say the input signal is sinusoid, and you can go through a whole bunch of math and so on and show that the total power of the quantization noise is delta squared divided by 12. That's the total power that is inside the quantization noise when you think about the quantization noise being distributed evenly across your entire spectrum. So having said that, you can also calculate what the total power of an input sinusoid signal will be that can fill all of your quantization levels. Again, you can go through the math, all of that, and you get to this very, very famous equation. And remember, this famous equation is calculated by dividing the total power of the signal at the input by dividing it by total power of the quantization noise. So the quantization noise can be statistically represented The input signal is assumed to be a sinusoid full-scale input into the quantizer. And if you go through the math, you get this really famous equation. What does this famous equation tell you? This equation tells you that the signal-to-noise ratio, and here again it's important, we're talking about signal-to-quantization noise ratio, not noise because of flicker, thermal, and shot noise sources. This is a quantization noise. We're not talking about any other source of degradation to SNR except for quantization. So here we will see that every time you increase the number of bits by one, and here is the number of bits, you get a 6 dB improvement in signal-to-quantization noise. So therefore, if I want to have an increased performance of 1 bit, I'm going to have to improve my SNR by 6 dB. That's another way of saying the same thing. And this is considered over half the sampling period. We are assuming that the ADC is running at a particular sampling period. So this is the signal to quantization noise ratio for half of that, the Nyquist criteria. So having said that, we can think about what the spectral content of a signal coming out of an ADC would look like. Well, it would look something like this. Here's a sampling frequency. Remember, between the sampling frequency and half the sampling frequency, we don't care about any of that. We can filter all that out anyway, because this is the part where your signal cannot be in, because it will quantize back in. So this doesn't matter. We have the signal that you're interested in. This is the main signal. And you have the quantization noise. The quantization noise is assumed to be white for a sinusoid input, and that's, you know, quite accurate. So having a flat quantization noise and having our signal in here, we said before that signal to quantization noise ratio is 6 times the number of bits plus 1.76 dB for an n-bit ADC. But there you go, that's perfect. But what if I want more? What if I want more bits? Well, if I want more signal to quantization noise ratio, well, one way to do it is to increase the number of n. Obviously, you make a, let's say you have an 8-bit ADC, you want more signal to the quantization noise ratio, we'll make a 9-bit ADC. But you will soon find out that it's very difficult to build ADCs with a high number of, with a very large resolution. And the reason for that is that component mismatches and other imperfections with integrated circuits will prevent you from cramming more and more bits into your ADC. So you have to find another way to increase your resolution. Also, making a very high resolution ADC, especially a flash ADC, will become inherently slow because you have a lot of components that need to operate at a high sample rate. So it becomes even more difficult. So at some point, you cannot make your ADC have more bits. You have to find another way of getting an improved signal to quantization noise ratio that's beyond your resolution. We want to distinguish here the difference between resolution and the affected number of bits. That is the difference between the number of levels in your quantizer and the effective number of bits that come out of the ADC. So having said that, well, one way to do it is, well, let's oversample our ADC. Why does that work? Now, remember that from the previous slide, that the quantization noise is spread evenly between DC and half the sampling period. So if I were to oversample my ADC by a higher, much higher sampling rate, so let's say I increase the sampling rate by a factor of k, I'm going to have the same total quantization noise. The total integrated quantization noise doesn't change, but now it is spread over a much larger frequency span, and that's the trick. So instead of it being spread from DC to half the sampling period, now it's spread from DC to k times the sampling period divided by 2. Why? Because I've just increased my sampling period by a factor of k. So all I've done is just made the spectral density to be lower, but the total integrated quantization noise is constant. Well, now that I've done this, I can actually go ahead and filter what I don't want. Because remember, I'm only interested in up to FS over 2, because that's the signal that I want to digitize. Beyond that, I don't care. So I can go ahead and filter all that out. So what does that mean? That means that because I've filtered between FS over 2 and KFS over 2, I am going to throw away this bunch of quantization noise. Before, I couldn't do that because before, I was interested in this entire bandwidth. Remember that this bandwidth that I'm interested in is exactly the same bandwidth that I'm going to retain here. Nothing has changed, except that because I've oversampled, I have this extra room to spare. I can throw away that quantization noise. Well, this sounds all nice and great, but remember that quantization noise is power. So every time I cut half of it off, I only gain 3 dB in signal to quantization noise ratio. So I oversampled by a factor of 2, I can get rid of half the quantization noise, but that only gives me 3 dB in signal to quantization noise. That's only half a bit. So let's do some basic calculation. So we get 3 dB reduction in quantization noise for every times 2 oversampling.
based on the original equation, if I want one bit of improvement in ENOB, I have to oversample by a factor of 4 because it's 6 dB per bit. So every time I oversample by a factor of 4, I get one bit extra. So let's see what happens. Let's say I have a 1 giga sample per second 4-bit ADC. And I want to turn that into a 12-bit ADC by oversampling it. Well, I would have to, I'm missing 8 bits. Every time I sample by a factor of 4, I get 1 bit. So I would need 1 giga sample per second times 4 to the 8, which is 65,536 giga samples per second. That's 65 tera samples per second. It's completely impractical. I can easily go from 4 bit to 5 bit because I will make the 1 giga sample per second multiplied by 4, I get 4 giga sample per second, then my 4 bit becomes 5 bit. But it's an exponential function, so it's very difficult to get high resolution this way. But people actually do this. If you look at the Agilent's HD scopes before they released the S series scopes, they took a 40 giga sample per second ADC, oversampled the 2.5 gigahertz signal in order to get their 10 bits coming out. So they didn't actually build a 10-bit ADC for their initial HD scope. Now they're doing it, but before they weren't. So this is done sometimes on rare occasions. But so it's impractical. Let's throw this away. Let's think about it in a different way. What if I could build something called a delta signal modulator that somehow did this for me? Then I could take the delta signal modulator output, which is going to be ones and zeros, pass it through a filter and decimeter and get my output back. Well, this sounds kind of like magic. But there is a very important and subtle thing here. Let's go back to appreciate it because this goes in the heart of the most important part of this. Remember, your signal is here. The quantization noise isn't added until you are at the quantization level. If there was a way for me to treat the input signal differently from the quantization noise, then I could separate them from one another. And that's the main trick. So let's go forward. And it will become all more clear. Here's an example of that. So here we have a first order delta signal modulator. The signal comes in, there's a difference amplifier, it's nothing more than a subtractor, and then there's an integrator, and there's a comparator, which is our 1-bit ADC. So we are going to build our delta signal modulator around the 1-bit ADC. So a 1-bit ADC obviously has barely over 7 dB of signal quantization noise ratio. But by oversampling it and by putting it into this loop, we can get much more. So here's our 1-bit ADC. Now remember, our signal is here. Our quantization noise is added here. They're added at two different points in this circuit. So if I were to put some kind of a feedback around it, it is possible such that I will have a transfer function that acts on the signal differently than it acts on the quantization noise itself. And if I am able to do that, then I can treat the quantization noise with a different transfer function than I can treat the input signal. Now, only if there was a way to let the signal go through but filter the quantization noise, and it turns out it is possible in this configuration because of the feedback. So what I'm doing is that I'm putting the input signal, subtracting it from some feedback value, and that feedback value is determined by the difference between the signal that was fed back by the error signal that was fed back from the input signal. So the input signal comes in, some quantization values, let's say it's a 1, then 1 comes back. Obviously 1 is going to be very different from my input signal. That comes back, gets subtracted from the input. Now it's the difference that's compared again, not the original signal. It's constantly the difference being subtracted. And there's an integrator in there, so it's an accumulation of the differences. So if we go forward in there, we can think about modeling that in this way. We can think of the delta, that's just a subtractor, and we have a one sample delay, that's our integrator, and then we have a 1-bit ADC, and that's where the quantization noise comes in, and then it's fed back through a 1-bit DAC, because remember, this is a digital signal, we want to feed back an analog signal, because the input is analog, so that's what this DAC is here for. It's essentially telling us that a 1 and a 0 that comes out of a digital signal is going to get mapped into some analog plus and minus value, and get fed back and subtracted with the input. So it is possible, and I'll show you this more detail, it turns out that this loop acts on this input signal like a low-pass filter, but acts on the error signal, the quantization signal, like a high-pass filter. So it actually takes the quantization noise and shapes it out of the band, which means it attenuates it inside the band and lets it through only outside of the band of interest. This is the trick. That's where it comes in. It's because of the fact that we are able to have two different transfer functions for the input signal and the noise that this actually does what it's supposed to do. So let's continue thinking about a little bit more. So this is what the output is going to look like. Now let's think about the input. The input is an analog signal. Let's imagine the input being a sinusoid. The output is a digital value, so either 1 or 0. And the error signal is the subtraction of the output from the input signal as it is fed back by the DAC. And if I were to look at it here, you can see it. Here's the blue is the output. It's just going to be 1s and 0s. The red is the input. It's going to be a sinusoid. And the green is the error signal. It's always the difference between these two signals, and that is the key, is that that error signal is continuously fed back, integrated and fed back, that gives rise to the transfer function that shapes the spectral noise. Now if I go forward, we can get into a little bit more math. We can think about the signal transfer function and the noise transfer function of a delta signal modulator. Now here, I'm showing it in the Z domain. Next, I'm going to show it in the S domain. The only difference is that Z domain is, of course, a discrete domain. It's been mapped onto the sampling frequency. But again, I'm sure you know, if you know about Z domain, S domain differences, you can appreciate how you can convert from one to the other. But this is easy in the Z domain to understand. Here's a signal, here's an integrator. This is a Z transform of a simple integrator. Here's our quantizer. Remember, a quantizer is nothing more than our one-bit ADC plus quantization noise. So you can always represent an ADC as a linear model being something that lets the signal through and adds quantization noise to it. That's all an ADC is. So then it goes through and is fed back and subtracted. So the signal transfer function is just Z to the minus 1, which is just a delay. You can calculate that. You can write it out and figure this out. It's just a delay. This is just algebra, by the way. You can very easily derive it. But the noise transfer function is 1 minus Z to the minus 1. It's actually a differentiator. So the transfer function from the input to the output is going to be a low-pass filter because it's an integrator. But the transfer function from this point to the output is going to be a high-pass, a differentiator, which means that it's going to get attenuated at the low frequencies of interest, and then it's going to increase amplitude afterwards. So we are applying this to the signal, we're applying this to the quantization noise. And that's where our signal to quantization noise improvement comes from. So let's take that a step further. Now let's think about it. This is now in the S domain, just to show you the converse of that. Now that we have a second order, now remember before we've always had, this is a first order because it only has one integrator. We can actually have a second order where we have two feedback paths and two integrators, integrator 1 and integrator 2. This time I'm showing the integrators in the S domain having a transfer function of omega P divided by S. And omega P here is the pole of the integrator. We can design that omega P to be anything we want depending on the input frequency requirements. So the signal comes in, goes through the first integrator, second integrator, goes through the ADC with the quantization noise added, and then the error signal is fed back, subtracted. The signal is fed back and then subtracted from each of the input in two stages. So having said that, we know that the output is going to be comprised of the transfer function that is acting upon the input signal, and NS, which is a noise transfer, quantization noise transfer function that's acting upon the quantization noise. That's going to be what's at the output. And you can calculate very easily what that is. The input transfer function is this, and the noise transfer function is that. Now, these are second-order transfer functions because this is a second-order delta sigma modulator. So how can we make sense of it? Well, it's very easy. Think about this one. Let's see if this is a high pass or a low pass, and it's an easy exercise. Let S be 0. If S is 0, then this term is 0, then this term is 0, then the transfer function at the input is just 1 over 1 is 1, which means that this transfer function of the input signal allows low frequencies to go through. If S is equal to infinity, which is a very, very high frequency, then this signal, this value becomes infinite, the denominator is infinite, and you have 1 over infinity, which is 0. So this transfer function lets the low frequency go through and filters the high frequency. Now, what about the noise transfer function acting on the quantization noise? Well, let S be equal to 0 again. If I let S be equal to 0, then this term is 0, this term is 0, this term is 0. You only have omega P. You have 0 over omega P is 0, which means that the noise transfer function does not allow low frequencies to go through. Now let S be infinity. Then you have a second order polynomial at the top and a second order polynomial at the bottom, and that means that this transfer function will approach a value of 1 at very, very high frequencies, which means that it will let very high frequencies go through. So these are actually opposites of each other. High pass. High pass applied to the quantization noise, low pass applied to the signal. And again, this is the trick of the delta sigma modulator. This is the subtlety behind it. There is a way to apply a different transfer function to the quantization noise than to the input. thus separating them, filtering the quantization noise in the frequencies that are of interest of VN, and filtering VN in the frequencies that are in the quantization noise, which is exactly what you want. You don't want to have quantization noise near your input signal, and that's what this does. In fact, this is actually very similar in some ways to how PLLs work. PLLs also have a way of applying a different phase transfer function to the VCO frequency than they apply the phase transfer function to the reference frequency. And I'll talk about a PLL some other time. I'll build a video for that some other time. But this concept is used elsewhere. So having said that, again, we can take it a step further. And I can actually plot for you A of S and N of S for some value of omega P. Let's say I want to build a delta sigma for audio applications. So if I'm building it for audio applications, I want omega P to be, you know, roughly in the tens of kilohertz. So let's go forward here. So here I've chosen 1 over omega P to be 8.5 microsecond. That's just some value I've picked for the circuits that we're building. So this is kind of for the audio application. So here's the transfer function of the input signal. So the input signal, looking at the output, this is what you're going to see. It's going to let all the low frequencies through, then it's going to become an attenuator. And the 3 dB of the attenuation for this value of omega P is going to be about 28 kilohertz, which is fine for audio applications. What about the noise transfer function? Here's the transfer function for the noise, starting from 100 hertz. And obviously this keeps going down. So here you can see this is a high pass filter. After about a frequency of about 12.2 kilohertz, then this is a 3 dB bandwidth, 3 dB frequency of the noise transfer function. You can see that at this point it's 3 dB below the nominal value, 0 dB. So now you can see that anything above 12.2 kilohertz, then is all the quantization is going to be let through. Now remember, the quantization is going to be shaped by this path, shaped by this transfer function. So we should be able to see this in measurement if everything is working. So if a signal is sitting here, it means that the signal transfer function is going to let it through, but the quantization is going to be attenuated, which is what we want. So what about higher orders? Well, we talked about the first order, and we've talked about the second order. Remember that when you go from first order to second order, your noise and signal transfer functions become second order. But you can build higher order delta sigma. You can continue building higher and harder, first, second, third, fourth. But it's not so straightforward. Once you reach a point of third and fourth and fifth order delta sigmas, there's actually impossible at some point. I can't quite remember if it was the fourth or the fifth order delta sigma, that you can't actually guarantee its stability. Remember, all these feedback networks have to be stable. This is tricky stuff. So you can't just continue to increase the delta sigma order. You're going to run into some wall. You're going to suddenly run into some problems. And also, meeting the speed requirements and bandwidth, and also all the other good stuff is going to become difficult as well. But there is something to be noted here, and that is that you get better and better bang for your buck for your oversampling by going to higher order. Remember, there is a difference. When we talk about delta sigma modulators and oversampling, these are two different concepts. Oversampling and delta sigma modulators go hand in hand. So if I have a first order loop or a second order loop or a third order loop, I get different benefits from different gain in signal to quantization and noise to ratio depending on the oversampling ratio. So let's say, for example, I'm oversampling by a factor of 32. A first order loop is going to give me and about 40 dB of improvement, but a second order is going to give me about 60, and a third order is going to give me about 80. So by going to higher order, I can get more from my oversampling ratio. In fact, there is an equation you can have to go through a whole bunch of math to derive what the signal to quantization noise ratio is for an arbitrary order delta sigma. So it turns out that for an L order delta sigma, every time you increase the sampling rate by a factor of 2, you get 6L plus 3 dB, or L plus half a bit of increase in dynamic range, here it says, but it's really signal to quantization noise ratio. So what does that mean? It means that, let's say I have a first order delta sigma, so L will be 1, which means that every time I double my sampling rate, I get 1.5 bit increase in signal to quantization noise. Remember, for a non-delta sigma, every time you double your sampling rate, you only get 0.5 bit of improvement. Here, every time you double your sampling rate, you get 1.5 bit. And if you build a second order, you get 2.5 bit. And a third order, you'll get 3.5 bit. So it's much, much more practical, it's much more reasonable for you to get the number of bits that you want. Let's say you have a second order delta sigma. So every time you double your sample rate, you get 2.5 bits increase. So going from 4 bit to 8 bits, you only need about 2 to the 3 oversampling rate, which is a factor of 8, not a factor of 65,000. So it's a huge, huge improvement. And every time you get a bit, remember that's 6 dB. 6 dB is 4 times the power. So you're reducing. So here, if you, every time you get 2.5 bit, for example, that's 2.5 times 6, that's 9. So you get 9 dB improvement. That's 2 to the 3, that's 8 times the reduction in power. That's a huge improvement. So anyhow, that's the main idea. So building higher order delta sigma modulators, you get more bang for your buck for your oversampling. So going forward, well, then what? Okay, we said all these wonderful things. Let's go back I don't even know how I did that. Let's keep going. So here we go. Here's our delta sigma model. But what comes out here is going to be a train of ones and zeros. Well, what do I do with that? Well, these trains of ones and zeros are coming out at the oversampled data rate. So let's say you're oversampling by a factor of 128. These bits are coming out at 128 bit faster the rate than you need them to be. So you need to deal with that somehow. And the other thing is that these are just ones and zeros. These are not digital words that you can use. So how can you use it? Well, you need to filter it. Remember, one thing we haven't talked about yet is what to do with the quantization noise. Let me go back here. So here's my quantization noise. This quantization noise is in the spectrum. I need to get rid of it somehow. The output signal is digital, so it's easy to get rid of because all I need to do is I need to apply a digital filter to my ones and zeros that are coming out. So if I were to apply a digital filter, I can cut out all the quantization noise. And that is the last step to get your signal to quantization noise ratio improvement, because you want this portion of the signal, this quantization noise, is still in your spectrum. The only way to get rid of it is to filter it. So you have ones and zeros coming out, and I want to do a filter. So how do I do that? I do it like this. My one bit comes in, then I build an FIR filter, for example. And remember, this is usually a sync function filter. So these one bits are coming in, and they're delayed and multiplied by a coefficient, delayed and multiplied by a coefficient. And these coefficients can be adjusted to get any filter shape that you want, depending on the depth of the FIR filter. And that's how you would do it. So this, sometimes people don't appreciate how can a one bit output from a delta sigma become multiple bits? Well, it becomes multiple bits after it's filtered, not right away. But this filter is still running at the full sample rate. So these multiple data are actually still coming out at the full rate. So one bit goes in, gets multiplied by a higher resolution coefficient, and what comes out is going to be a multi-bit word. Let's say my delta sigma is a 16-bit delta sigma, and my filter is designed such a way that one bit comes in, let's say one bit at 1 gigasample per second comes in, then 16-bit at 1 gigasample per second will come out. So let's go forward. So which means that after the filtering, what you're going to end up with is a multi-bit word like this one. This is a very, very large resolution ADC. So you can see these now your digital values are going to have a very long number of bits associated with them. And then you filter all this out. So that shape that used to be here is now filtered out by a digital filter. Now this is still has a lot of extra samples. It's way over the Likert's criteria because it's determined by the oversampling ratio. The next step is to decimate it. And the decimation is nothing more than just taking every other sample. So if you only are interested in a particular, let's say you want only 1 kilosample per second, but you have oversampled by a factor of 1,000, then you throw away every 1,000, you only keep every 1,000 digital word that comes out. And then eventually you get this. And this will then be the final output of the delta sigma ADC. This will have the high resolution you want. So it's not only multiple bits, it also is at the data rate that you want that meets the Nyquist criteria. Well, this is all nice and great, but how do I build this? Well, building the decimator and the filters is really tough. I want to avoid that because I want to find another way of showing you the spectrum. I want to find another way to show you this spectrum plus the signal without having to build the decimator and the filter and all of that. Well, there is a way to do that. But this is a very subtle difference that I want you to think very carefully about. This is what's coming out of the delta sigma. It's ones and zeros, basically. And here it's ones and negative ones, but it doesn't matter. Remember that this is in discrete domain. This is not a continuous time signal anymore. We are dealing with ones and zeros, not an analog signal. But when you measure it on the oscilloscope, of course, we live in a continuous domain signal. So what you're going to see is you're going to see a square wavish shape kind of thing, like I showed you in one of the earlier slides, that blue output. That's because we live in a continuous world. In reality, what's happening is that this signal is being convolved with a zero order hold, which means that in between each of the digital signals, you hold the value until the next bit comes along. So what you will see on the oscilloscope is the convolution of your digital pattern in the discrete domain with a zero order hold to bring it into the continuous domain. And then you will see something like this on the oscilloscope. Now, when I have this on the oscilloscope, remember that this is nothing more than my digital bits convolved with a zero order hold. So in theory, the spectral content of this is nothing more than the spectral content of this signal multiplied by the spectral content of a zero order hold, which is a sync function. But because this zero order hold, its width is equal to the oversampling ratio, the nulls in the sync function do not interfere with the spectral interest. Now, I said a lot of stuff. I want you to really understand this, because this is a very important and subtle point, that why we can do this and what is actually happening. These are stuff that are hard to find in books because it's really a practical issue. So I'll say it again. The output of the ADC is in the discrete domain because it's ones and zeros. The only values that are of importance are ones and zeros between the samples coming out at the sampling rate. Coming back to the analog domain, into the continuous domain, is equivalent of convolving with a zero order hold, which in the frequency is equivalent to multiplying it by a sync function. Having said that, the sync function's nulls only land at the sampling rate, which is oversampled far beyond the spectrum that you're interested in. So the spectrum of the signal is only a small part of the sync function. So therefore, for all practical purposes, this sync function is kind of flat at the top for the regions that you're interested in. So you can ignore it. But you must know that it is there because it is part of the system. And I'll show you that during measurement and you will see that it actually is there. And nonetheless, this means that I can see the spectral shape and the noise shaping of a delta sigma by looking at the spectral content of this signal without the filter and decimation and all that, as opposed to trying to look at the spectral content of this signal, which would require me to capture the digital bits individually and then process them separately. So I can actually look at the FFT of this, and it will be the FFT of that multiplied by a sync function. And that's very, very important. Well, I hope you're still there. So let's build this. I want to build a second order delta sigma. How do I do it? Well, this is my block diagram. I want to emulate this in circuit. Well, I'm going to build a really, really simple one. And here's the circuit. Let's walk through it. We need a 1-bit quantizer and a sampler. What is a 1-bit ADC? A 1-bit ADC is nothing more than a comparator and a flip-flop. The comparator is our quantizer. The comparator is what determines whether it's a 1 or a 0. It just compares it to a value. That's our 1-bit comparator. Our flip-flop here is our sampler, essentially. So the combination of these two will become our 1-bit ADC. The timing of the timing of the flip-flop will determine our sample rate. So I can clock the flip-flop, let's say at 300 kHz. That will be my 1-bit ADC sample rate. So together, these two together is a 1-bit 300 kilosample per second ADC. That's our quantization noise and all of our stuff that goes into here. That sets by that. Now I need to have two integrators. Remember in one of my earlier videos, I showed you this circuit. Just this, forget about everything else. The resistor and the capacitor, this is an integrator. We went over the derivation of this in one of my earlier videos, so you can go ahead and look at it. So this is an integrator. Here's the second one, exactly the same. I've chosen the value of 850 ohm and 10 nanofarad to meet these transfer functions. So 850 ohm and 10 nanofarad gives me a time constant of 8.5 microseconds, which will then give me these transfer functions, which we can verify in measurements. So having said that, we have one integrator, two integrator. Here's the first one, here's the second one. Omega P in the integrator is determined by this value of these resistors. I also need the feedback value. Well, I can still do that by using the same integrator, by adding a resistor here. Now, think about this. This integrator, forget the output of it. Just think about this point and the output. Nothing else matters. So I have one input coming this way, and then I can have another input coming this way. But because this is a linear time invariant system, it is the superposition of these two values that determine the overall transfer function. So actually, it turns out that by doing this, I can add the signal here and the signal here. And if I invert it, I can subtract it. So this circuit here actually does both this subtraction and the integration. Here's the input. This point here is that point there. The subtraction is done at this point. Here's the integrated as a whole, and here's the input. Same thing with the second one. Now, since this is an inverting signal, I have to take the output from the positive output of the flip-flop or the negative output of the flip-flop in order to meet the positive and negative requirements of this block diagram. I want you to go through this in your head and convince yourself that it works, because it does. Having said that, also, it's important to note that we don't have a DAC. Why? Because I'm just using the output of the flip-flop as my DAC. I'm going to bias the flip-flop with positive and negative power supplies to make sure that what comes out is going to be a positive and negative input in order to be able to feed it back here. So it's just a bunch of other little details that you can think about, but it's pretty straightforward to build. If you have any more questions, ask in the comment section so I can clarify it for you a little bit more. So, all right, I hope you're still there. Now I want to build this circuit. All I need is an op-amp, a comparator, a flip-flop, and a bunch of passives. And then, according to the theory, this thing should be a second-order delta sigma modulator with a 1-bit ADC and a feedback pack, a 1-bit DAC, that's going to do noise shaping for us. Well, let me show you the setup, let me show you how I've built it, and let's measure it. So here's a bird's-eye view of our setup. Okay, I've put everything down carefully because I want to be able to explain it to you exactly how it works. And I have a puzzle for you, a little quiz for you, see if you can figure it out. So what is involved? Well, here's our PCB, or the breadboard, I should say, where the circuit that I showed you just a moment ago has been laid out. So I'll go through that. We have here an Agilent E4432B, this one. This is going to be our input signal, the signal we're going to quantize. I have a Regal DG5352, which is going to be our clock signal. This is going to provide the clock, the oversampling clock to the flip-flop. I have a Regal DP1308A. This is our dual power supply to provide us a plus and minus power supply to power the op-amps and the comparators and everything. And then I have the Tektronix MDO4104B-6. And this is going to be it's going to collect our digital signals and our analog signals. We're going to do our FFTs and everything. And everything else is already hooked up and covered, collected. Now, the puzzle that I have for you is the following. The Regal DG5352 has two outputs. I can easily use this to provide both the clock and the input signal that's being quantized. But why am I not doing that? What's the problem with using both signals from the same source? You have to think a little bit about that. But anyhow, for now, just for you know, this is our clock, this is our input signal. So I'm going to give you a closer look on the little breadboard before we power everything on and see if it actually does what it's supposed to. Okay, so remember that all the documents that I showed you, all the slides that I've made, they're always available on my website for download. So you can always download and look at them while I'm talking about the circuits. So here's the breadboard, everything laid out. Here's my first op-amp, it's my first integrator. The first integrator uses these capacitors. Now I have two capacitors because there are twice the value, so they're in series. So really there should be only one in reality. So here's the first op-amp, here's the integrator, here's the input resistor, here's the resistor to the next op-amp. Here's the second op-amp, the second integrator, here are its feedback capacitors, the Miller integrator, so here are its feedback capacitors. And therefore the output of this then goes on all the way up to the comparator. So here you can see the output going through a resistor to the second op-amp, going directly to the comparator. This comparator is an LM311N. This is an open collector comparator. Now be very careful, because this is a fully bipolar open collector comparator, meaning that it has no way of pulling its output to VDD by itself, because it's all NPNs. So it needs a pull-up resistor. Without this pull-up resistor, the output of the comparator can never reach VDD. So all the op-amps are powered from plus and minus supplies. And everything, in fact, is powered from plus and minus supplies, and ground being the reference. Even the flip-flop, because remember, the flip-flop is also our DAC. So its output has to be plus and minus in order to be fed back to the op-amps themselves. So again, here's the op-amp comparator. Flip-flop, there's two flip-flops in here. I'm not using one of them. The one at the top is the pins at the top are unused, and the pins at the bottom are used. So here's the Q bar and Q outputs of the flip-flop, and they're fed back again through two resistors all the way back to the first op-amp and fed back to the second op-amp. So this actually is a complete circuit. It covers everything. There's a couple of little other things. There's a 50 ohm resistor here in order to terminate the clock to 50 ohm, because the output driver of my Regal arbitrary waveform generator is 50 ohms. And there is very generous amount of the coupling caps distributed along the power supply. Make sure everything is as quiet as possible. These lines here provide the power supply. Here's my input signal coming from the adjutant source, clock coming from the Regal source. Oscilloscope probe to monitor the output, oscilloscope probe to monitor the input, so we can look at the input and output simultaneously, and we can also look at the error signals on anywhere along the PCB. So I hope that's clear, so you can see exactly how it works. I can also try and show it to you on here. So again, there goes my computer. Never mind, it doesn't have enough battery for me to show you. But it's okay. It's still fairly clear about how this is laid out. So let's take a look a little bit again, further out. You can see the power supply cables going out to Regal here. You can see the input signal going to Agilent, the clock signal going to another Regal, and of course, my pride and joy, the Tektronix MDO-4000B, is going to look at all the signals. So let's take a closer look at how the equipment is set up, just to be sure, so you can replicate this for yourself. So I have a plus and minus 5 volt supply. Remember that all the components, including the op-amps and the comparators and the flip-flop, are running from plus and minus 5 volts, so that I can use the output of the D flip-flop as to be my DAC as well as my ADC, because it's supposed to be fed back to the integrators. So plus and minus 5 volt setup, it's consuming about 45 milliamps or so from each supply. Not too bad. The Regal arbitrary waveform generator here is set to provide our clock. So it's set to provide a square wave at 256 kilohertz at plus or minus 4 volts. And the reason again is plus or minus 4 volts because the D flip-flops are biased at plus or minus, so you need to make sure your clock is also plus or minus at 50% duty cycle. So this will be our clock. So remember, our clock is 256 kilohertz. Then we come to our signal. Our signal is, I'm using here, I can get this all in there. I'm using the Agilent E4432B. I'm using the LF output, the low frequency output, because the main output, the RF output, doesn't go below 250 kHz. I have the LF option on this unit, so I can go from DC to 250 kHz using that. And it's set to be a 1.7 volt peak, so it's about 4 volts peak to peak. And if the function is at the frequency is at 2 kHz. So if the frequency is at 2 kHz and the oversampling ratio and the clock frequency is at 256, so we have an oversampling ratio of 128. So we have a delta sigma modulator, second order, with an oversampling ratio of 128. And we should be able to see the shape of the waveform to correspond to exactly what I just described based on the theory and the circuit that you saw. So let's take a look at the instrument, see if it is what we expected. Here we go. So there is the Tektronix scope output, and I'll explain to you what it is that we're looking at. Here we go. So I have set this scope to channel 1, which is yellow, is the output of the delta sigma. So that's our digital output. Let me zoom out a little bit more. So that's our digital output. Digital output is on the yellow, and our analog input is on channel 3, so that's the pink waveform that you see. And you can. There's some measurements being done on it. Again, the output is 9 volts peak to peak because I'm using plus and minus 5 volts and so on and on. So you can see them both at the same time. Now you can't really tell much about this, but I can zoom in and tell you what actually the waveform is doing. Remember, the delta sigma ADC output is only 1 bit, and it's the density of ones with respect to the zeros is what you're supposed to be looking at, because it's the whole pattern of ones and zeros that's supposed to represent the analog input signal. So let's do a single capture. Let's zoom in a little bit, and let's take a closer look. Now look here. When the signal is high, you see more ones. When the signal is low, you see more zeros. When the signal is at zero, you see equal numbers of ones and zeros, which is exactly what you would want to see. The density of the ones and zeros in this waveform is what is determining the actual digital representation of this analog signal. So I can capture this multiple times, doesn't matter. Again, you can see when the signal is high, more ones, signal is low, more zeros, and in here, equal numbers of ones and zeros. So how can I be sure? Well, there are several ways to be sure. You can look at it in the spectral domain, which is what we will do, or you can take an average of the signal. Let's try that. If I were to take an average of this yellow signal, the channel one, the digital output, it should roughly represent the signal that's at the input, because remember, the average is going to be the average value. So here the average value is going to have more ones in it, here the average value is going to have more negative ones in it, and here the average value is going to have zero. So if I were to average the input signal, it should resemble this pink line. Let's try it. So let's run it like so, and let's go under acquire and go under averaging. Look at that. It's kind of like magic, isn't it? Those are ones and zeros, but if I average them, it's going to resemble the input signal. Now it's going to have a more quantization noise on it because I'm not averaging it perfectly, but it is indeed matching the output, even though when I go back to the high resolution mode, it's just ones and zeros. It's just that the area, the total area under each one and zero, the density, the pulse width, you can even think about it, is what represents the analog value. But I can take it a step further. We looked at the signal when there is a signal and how the output correlates to it, but let's turn the signal completely off. If I turn the signal completely off, then what do I have? Now if I were to take a single capture, which of course is not going to work because the trigger is on the wrong channel, so let's put it like that. There you go. Now it's triggering on the digital signal itself. Now look at what's happening now and how it's different from before. Here, the density of ones and zeros is the same no matter where you are in the waveform. That is because it's trying to represent a value of zero. Therefore, if I were to average an equal number of positive ones and negative ones, what do I get? I get zero. But if I were to turn my input signal on and take another single capture, now the total number of ones and zeros is going to depend on where this channel one waveform is. So now I'm going to have much more zeros here and much more ones there. I can turn the input signal off again and take a single capture, and you can see that again, it goes back to being equal numbers of ones and zeros. So remember that we took an average before, and the yellow waveform represented the input signal. Now there is no signal. So what if I take an average now? What do we expect to see? We expect to see zero. So you can go under acquire and then go back on averaging. And look at that, you get nothing. So this means that the total number of ones and zeros are the same, which is what you expected because there is no input signal. So this verifies, kind of in the time domain, what we want to see. This shows us that indeed we are having, I can apply the signal again, indeed if I were to average the input signal, that it is in fact going to give us the signal we are looking for in the frequency domain. But that doesn't mean that it's actually working. It's just a very rough representation of what we wanted to see. You can see the input signal here again. You can see the input signal, the average of the input signal is following, the output is following the input. But to really understand it, we want to see noise shaping. So how do I do that? Well, let's go ahead and turn the averaging off, go to high resolution mode. So that's what we want to see. Well, let's look at the FFT of the input signal first. So let me go under math, and let's go under source and make the source be 3. Again, setting up the instrument for you to look at it correctly is very important. So remember, let me turn this one off. I just want to look at the FFT of the input signal. Now I'm at 100 megasamples per second. It's way, way too many. So let's go down all the way to, oops, I'm going the wrong way. Let's say one megasample per second. And let's go on to under our FFT menu. Let me turn this off because it's just going to be annoying. So let's go under FFT menu, and let's set our frequencies correctly. We only want to look all the way up to, let's say, 62.5 kilohertz. And we're going to see it at 12.5 kilohertz per division, like so. And let's change this to 10 dB per division. There. Now look at this. This is 10 dB per division. This is my main tone, right up there. That is at 2 kilohertz. That's my input signal. That's this signal. Okay, now I'm basically looking at a very large duration of the signal in order to have spectral resolution. Again, I'm gonna repeat some of this theory to you. We are doing 1 million samples per second. We are capturing 100,000 points, and we are applying an FFT to that. The reason I wanted to do 1 million samples per second and 100 kilopoints is because I want to have the proper spectral resolution. You have to go back and look at your FFT theory to appreciate this. But this is our input signal. These tones that you see here are coming, part of them are coming from the DAC inside the adjuvant generator. Some of them are because of the nonlinearities of the oscilloscope itself. But you can see that we have a huge signal-to-noise ratio here because the signal is very pure. The tone that I'm applying at the input is very pure. Well, that's all nice and great, but what about the spectral content of the output? I want to see the spectral content of this signal. So that's easy to do. We just have to change the source of the FFT. So we select FFT again. This time I'm going to say, look at source 1. There. Look at that. Does that look familiar or what? Here's my input signal and here's my noise shaping. Exactly as theory predicted. This is my 2 kilohertz input signal. Here's the region where you want your signal to be in. This is the bottom of the quantization noise. And here's the noise shaping outside the spectrum that you're not interested in. So if I were to filter from here down to here, I will get rid of all the quantization noise. And this is in fact exactly what we wanted to see. We wanted to see a noise shaping being applied to this signal. But we can do a little bit more interesting things than that. Let's verify if our transfer function of our signal matches what we expected it to be. So I want to measure the transfer function of the input signal. Our theory said it was supposed to be around 28, 29 kilohertz. So let's measure that. So here's our main tone, is at 2 kilohertz right now. So let me turn the cursors on. I've already placed the cursor A to be at the peak of my input signal. And cursor B, this horizontal line, is set to be 3 dB below. So you can see the delta there is about 3 dB below. So which means that if I keep increasing the input signal, eventually the peak of the signal will go from that point to that point, meaning that it will drop by 3 dB. And that drop by 3 dB is our 3 dB band of our input signal. That's the transfer function that's being applied to the input signal. And we know what it is based on theory and based on the components that I have chosen on this board here, 850 ohm and 10 nanofarad, is supposed to give us about 28, 29 kilohertz. So let's keep increasing the input signal and see if that happens. Remember, we want this peak, the peak value of the signal to go from marker A to marker B. So let's go ahead and increase that. So right now at 2 kilohertz, and now it's at 10 kilohertz. You can see it's already come down a little bit. Let's go higher, 14 kilohertz. This is 22 kilohertz, 28 kilohertz, and right there it is, 29, 30 kilohertz. So you can see that the input transfer function of the ADC, of this Delta Sigma ADC, matches really well with the theory. And that tells us that we do have indeed the transfer function we want to see from the input, and the input is going to continue to go down. If I increase the frequency, it will continue to go down because a low pass filter is being applied to it. Yeah, I can go even higher, it's 48 kilohertz, you can see it's even gone lower, and so on and on. So let me go back to 2 kilohertz here again. So we have verified that the input transfer function of this ADC matches the theory, and we have seen that the noise shaping is indeed also happening. So that's basically everything we need to know to make sure that this is in fact doing what it's supposed to do based on the theory of the delta sigma modulation, as well as doing the measurement itself. So let me do one other thing that I wanted to do. A couple of other things. Right now, we are sampling at 256 kilohertz, and you can see that here. Our sampling rate is 256 kilohertz, and we are sampling a 2 kilohertz signal, so our oversampling ratio is 128. Okay, that's great. But we also know what happens if you increase our oversampling ratio, and I want to show you that it is indeed doing what it's supposed to do. Let me turn the cursors off. So, what is the oversampling ratio going to do for us? The oversampling ratio in any ADC, especially in the Delta Sigma second order, is going to lower the quantization noise floor even more. So it's going to give us even more signal to noise ratio up here. So I'm going to go from 256 kilohertz to 512. So I'm going to increase the oversampling ratio from 128 to 256. So I'm setting the input signal to now 512 kilohertz, and have your eye on the spectrum, and let. Do you see that? You see how the quantization noise floor went even lower, and the shape of the spectrum changed, and I'm gonna go back to 256 again. There, so you can see that the oversampling ratio indeed does work, and you can improve the signal to quantization noise ratio in the band of interest, in this bandwidth right here, by changing the oversampling ratio. And again, this spectrum is the spectrum of the ones and zeros that we were looking at before, and these ones and zeros have the zero order hold as I described to you before. Now, remember I said that there is a zero order hold here. How can we verify that? Well, we can verify that by looking at even a longer portion of the spectrum. So let's go ahead and do that and see if it is true, if we see the sync function in this spectrum or not. So what I can do is I can go out to FFT and I can increase this to 25 kilohertz and this to 128 kilohertz. You can begin to see it, so I can increase it even more. Actually, what I'm going to do is I'm going to increase the sample rate to 2.5. There. Look at that. Is that what you were expecting to see? Ears are noise shaping at the very beginning. Remember, this is a much, much wider frequency we're looking at. Our noise shaping is right here at the beginning. The signal is right there. You can barely see it. And then you can see that the noise shaping, and this is the sync function. What is this frequency supposed to be? This frequency is supposed to be our sampling frequency. And there are two tones here. I'm gonna leave that as another puzzle for you. What are these two tones and why are they there? Remember, this is a sync function determined by the sampling frequency of the ADC, but there are two tones here as opposed to only one tone. And I want you to think about that and tell me why you think there are two tones. There are very, very subtle points that I want you to think about. So we have verified our zero order hold, we have verified our noise shaping, we verified our input transfer function, but what are some of the things that can go wrong? So let me put that back to where it was. Let's go down to 1 megasample per second. You can see again, there's two tones here, it's supposed to be one. I'll let you think about that. This is supposed to be at 256. So here's our main tone. Let me change the FFT back to what it was. 12.5 kilohertz per division, 62.5 kilohertz there. So we can see our signal again and our noise shaping and everything again. Well, what are some of the things that can go wrong? What determines the linearity? Now we're talking about a different concept. Now we're talking about distortion due to nonlinearities. Now, let's think about the circuit here. The comparator and the flip-flop are always linear. Why? Because a 1-bit DAC and a 1-bit ADC is always linear. Because there's only one way to connect two dots together, by a straight line. It cannot deviate from a straight line. So you cannot really get nonlinearities from here. You can get other problems like timing uncertainty, jitter, and other types of problems, but not nonlinearity. However, these op-amps here, these op-amps in fact are responsible for resolving the error signal and also for passing the input signal through. So if these op-amps are nonlinear, then you are going to get distortion. Excuse me, distortion. How would that distortion show up? Well, that distortion will show up in the spectrum as harmonics of the input. And if there are two tones at the input, it's going to show up as intermodulation products of the input. So it is possible to make this delta sigma nonlinear, even though it only uses a 1-bit ADC and a 1-bit DAC. Well, what's the easiest way to make it nonlinear? Well, let's reduce the power supply of the op-amps. Let's force the op-amps to run into power supply headrooms, and then we will be able to see nonlinearities pop up. And that's very easy to verify. Right now I'm at 5 volts. I'm going to go ahead and increase my power supply. 5 volts, now I'm at 4 volts. Aha, look at that. You see that? It's beginning to creep up. Now I'm going to go to 3 volts. Now it's going to get really bad. You see that? Now the shape of the spectrum also changed, obviously, because now there is quantization noise is handled differently by the op-amps. You're now quantizing the harmonics, and there's a whole bunch of other problems. But the main thing that I wanted to bring up is a look at this nonlinearity. This nonlinearity that you see here is only because the op-amps have run into a nonlinearity issue. It's nothing to do with the ADC and the DAC. And if I were to increase the power supply again, you can see that the harmonic is gone. Another way to cause distortion is to increase the input signal. So right now I'm at 1.7 volt peak. I can go to 2.7 volt peak. You see? Now the input signal is again too large and the op-amps are running into nonlinearity. So the full-scale input of the ADC is just as important in delta sigma as it would be in a regular flash ADC or a different type of ADC. So right now I'm running it in kind of a sweet spot. And so you can see that you can run into nonlinearity problems. There is one last thing I wanted to show you. We looked at the, let me turn the FFT off. Let me turn the input signal on and this one on. Make sure I'm triggering here. Perfect. So let me zoom in here. So we saw this. We saw the input signal. We saw the waveform. Let's look at the error signal. I'm going to pick the error signal of one of the op amps. And that is the input to the op amp. If I can plug it in somewhere. There. There is our error signal. Let me do a single shot. Look at that. Do you remember that waveform that I showed you on one of the slides? This is the error signal being processed by the op amp. So the input signal, this is a second order delta signal, so the error signal is not going to look like exactly like what you saw, which was for the first order delta signal. But you can see the error signal is indeed being processed by the op amp. And you can see here, I'm looking at the error signal at the input one of the op amps. So there it is. That kind of covers everything, and I tried to make this video a little bit shorter toward the end because I realized it's running very long. But again, I hope that you learned quite a lot about delta sigma ADCs, and that you enjoyed the video, and that you got something, you learned something you didn't know before. Now, my only request is that please take it just a brief moment to like the video and subscribe to the channel and leave a comment. I don't usually care about these things, but the reason I ask is because the engagement, your engagement with the videos will determine how many people will be willing to just send me equipment or parts or so on, because companies want to see engagement with the videos so that they know that the viewers are watching the whole thing. So please do me a favor, do these a couple of things. It will only take you a few seconds, and it's going to allow me to be able to bring you equipments in the future and do other interesting things in the future. So leave a comment and let me know what you think. If you have any questions, we'll try to get a discussion going. Until next time.